Why hasn't artificial intelligence caught on more? My guest is Rich Nanda, Principal for Strategy and Analytics at Deloitte Consulting. Hello, Rich.
Hi, Robert.
Thanks for joining me. So as I'm sure you've heard, statistics say that only 12% of supply chain professionals are using AI and emerging technology as a management tool right now. Why such a small number?
Yeah, well, Robert, first of all, thank you for having me. Look, there's no question we're still in the early days of AI adoption within the enterprise and in supply chain. But I think what we're seeing is a very quick acceleration from low levels of adoption and application to learning happening, expertise being built, and business benefit being realized that's creating more interest and more adoption. And I think what we believe is, you know, the learning curve and the adoption curve is going to continue to accelerate as companies dip their toes in the water and get benefit. Our data would suggest a little more than 12% at the enterprise level. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, around 30%.
Oh, that's a big difference.
Might be that customer-facing organizations, perhaps, or finance organizations have led the charge for enterprises, and, you know, supply chain may be coming next.
So as with all new technologies, you need a few leaders, innovators to start using it, show success in it, and then everybody else kind of climbs onto the train after that. And that's what we're seeing right now, you think?
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Where is it? Where's the technology? I mean, you mentioned just now a little bit about the customer facing aspect, but where is the technology really making a splash right now? Where is it most advanced?
Yeah, look, I think the two domains that I mentioned, the customer facing domain is one place where the technology has a number of here and now applications that you or I as consumers are experiencing. When you call most call centers today, there is a level of AI that is being used as enterprises in those call centers are processing who we are. And many times we'll get that automated menu. That's AI at work. The home electronics that we use, again, consumer facing, that is all AI at work in terms of things like your Siri device helping you with the morning news or the weather. And so consumer facing, customer facing, definitely one place. And then finance would be other, where kind of very repeatable, high volume tasks have been in place that we've just been able to apply automation and maybe early stage AI to help with. Those are two places where adoption has been maybe more significant than others.
Any industries where it is especially lagging?
Well, let me start where it's leading industry-wise. TMT, tech, media, telecom companies, because technology, advanced technology has always been the core product and service, you're seeing strong adoption there. Consumer and finance organizations, because of the volumes and the consumer facing, you've seen it there. And then lagging on the industrials side, more supply chain, manufacturing intensive organizations, that's where things have been lagging.
Mm-hmm. What obstacles are there to acceptance, do you think, other than unfamiliarity and just the time it takes to get used to new technology? Are there any other things that stand in the way, and at least in the minds of the companies that are slow to adopt, that stand in the way of their adopting?
Yeah, well, you named two really important ones to start with. The other that I see is just executive mandates. Mm-hmm. And when top leadership understands the influence of advanced technology and artificial intelligence on, the organization's ability to remain competitive, to remain effective, and they kind of create a mandate and a burning platform with the company, then, many things ensue when top leadership, creates that type of mandate. And so that would be another very big unlock is, you have leaders that are bought in. That this isn't science fiction. This is actually here and now, and it's incumbent on the organization to come up that learning curve.
Is there a cost consideration, though, for jumping into it for the first time? Is that enough to deter executives from wanting to open up their wallets to that extent?
Of course, there's always a cost, but what I've seen is executives that have created that mandate are thinking about this as R&D, right? And leading companies are going to invest in R&D in their products and their services, and enriching those products and services with data and analytics is another form of R&D. R&D applied to the functions, again, advanced companies think about R&D just, you know, beyond just products and services. So if you know, that leadership team and the CFO can include this as part of the R&D where there's real returns expected, I think that's you know, a pretty important unlock.
So what is the selling point anyway? I mean, what is it that AI can do, especially with regard to helping supply chains deal with fluctuating demand?
Yeah, look, the I think we've lived through a really interesting past year that brings to life exactly what AI can help do, which is when you're dealing with wild fluctuations in demand, and we saw really wild fluctuations. By the way, they don't have to be as significant as they were with COVID fluctuations, as your audience well knows, even small ones can be highly disruptive to a supply chain. So understanding those fluctuations with speed, so anticipating them and shortening the timeline from when that anticipation is understood is one benefit. And then the second is having a greater amount of throughput. So how many signals can you process without human intervention, right? And so that's the other benefit, is automation and AI can process more information and then get it to the last mile where human intervention then can do the final interpretation of those signals. So you get speed benefit and you get throughput, the ability to manage more signals.
It almost feels like, given the huge volume of data the supply chains are dealing with today, they have no choice but to turn to AI to make sense of it, especially when it comes to both structured and unstructured data. Is that in fact the case?
That's the case, Robert. And look, we're just at the front end of the digitization of supply chains at the next level. So as smart logistics, smart packaging, as those create more signals, more digital signals, it's only going to increase how smart a supply chain can become, or how confused it can become as you know, more digital, more products become tethered to the digital infrastructure that's out there. We're at the front end of that digitization.
Do you think that had AI been prevalent in most companies and supply chains prior to the pandemic, that it would have handled the pandemic in a better way? Or was it just a question of this is how it's going to happen no matter what?
Well, look, the pandemic is a very extreme shock. But I would say AI savvy companies responded more efficiently than those that were processing things in a more traditional fashion. So yes, I do think AI savvy companies benefited from the extreme shock of COVID that it had on the supply chains. But I think that benefit's gonna carry forward, that benefit of how they became a smarter, more responsive supply chain into the future as well.
It feels a little like we broadened the definition of what is AI compared with what it was defined as like back in its early days, 50s, 60s, 70s and the like, when the whole idea was, well, we got to create these machines that think like people. Now it seems like it's a more practical application. We just need AI to make business decisions that humans couldn't make because, as we said before, the large amount of data, unpredictability of supply chain. So have we, in fact, sort of changed the goalposts a little bit to make it easier to say that we are indeed using AI now?
Yeah, I'm not sure I'd say we've moved the goalposts. I think what's happened is the real world applications are becoming more as the economy digitizes, as supply chains digitize, as consumer experience digitizes, the need for algorithms to aid humans in decision making, the use cases are all around us now. Mm-hmm. So is that the goalpost moving, or is that just more opportunities to deploy AI? You know, I'll leave that to the listeners to decide. But to me, the idea that the use cases are all around us now is what makes things so much more interesting today than perhaps when AI was, you know, a university project 50 or 60 years ago.
So would it be fair to say that perhaps we are right on the verge of an explosion of the use of AI, that it's going to get really big in a very short time? Is that how you feel about it?
That's my belief. You know, if you just look at how much of our economy is digitized today. We're still at the 10 to 15% range. We're well on our way to the majority of our supply chain being, the economy and supply chain being digitized. And as that happens, more and more use cases and opportunities to compete differently and become more effective will be here for the taking.
And maybe, just maybe, when the next big disruption comes along, maybe we will be able to handle it a little better than we have in the past, right?
Indeed.
Yeah, well, that's some positive news. And I'm glad to hear that your 30% is a lot more than the 12%, and that maybe we are on the road to real acceptance of artificial intelligence. Rich Nanda, thank you so much for talking to me about it today. I really appreciate your insights.
Yeah, my pleasure, Robert. Thanks for having me.